But it was more the epiphany I had.
They all, a lot of them do. Yeah. A lot of them have the same routine.
Yeah. You're all set.
Thank you, Kristen. Good evening, everybody. This is a regularly scheduled meeting of the Wareham School Committee. It's January 27th, 2016, approximately 7 p.m. The meeting is now called to order. As with the last meeting, we have one of our members who has notified me in advance that she will be participating remotely this evening due to geographic distance. All votes, therefore, will be done by roll call. We are all so.
Can you talk in your microphone?
Should I repeat what I just said, Kristen, or are we good?
It may help the people at home because I was having trouble hearing you.
Okay, sorry, those people who are listening remotely. Judy Caparicio has informed me in advance that she will be participating remotely due to geographic distance. All votes will therefore be done by roll call, and we are being recorded for by WCTV and by audio by Mrs. Ruiz, our recording secretary, administrative assistant, everything else. We will begin the meeting with public participation. Is there anybody here who would like to address the committee? Seeing none, I will move on to good news. Madam Superintendent.
I would like to share that we're currently hosting a group of high school and middle school students from Shanghai. Our guests arrived this past Monday and will spend 2 weeks with our host families, and they will depart for home on February 6th. Activities will include a tour of Boston, Stonehill College, attending classes and activities with our host students and their families. We certainly appreciate the willingness of our families to host students, as this is a valuable experience for all.
That's great. I assume these are different students than the last group?
Yes.
Okay. This is Shanghai?
Shanghai.
And where was the last group from?
Beijing.
Great. Noah, anything happening at the high school?
Yeah, a couple of things happen in the next couple of weeks. February 3rd is going to be at 5 o'clock the induction for the National Honor Society. Getting in a bunch of new students, it'd be good to see them come into the club.
Okay, and so just to be clear, this was the induction that was going to occur last Sunday.
Yeah, last Sunday.
Then I heard a rumor it was going to be this Sunday, but it's not going to
nope.
be. It's going to be Wednesday, February 3rd.
February 3rd, 5 o'clock.
Great.
And February 5th, Friday, at 6:30, the girls' basketball team is hosting a basketball game, and they're going to have raffles and auction items and other things that will be all that will be collecting money for Trey Miranda, the student at Wareham High School that has been undergoing much different surgeries and health problems, and it'd be good if you could come to the game, donate, and help out.
What date is that again, Noah?
February 5th, 6:30.
A Friday. Okay.
Yep.
Okay. Thank you, Noah. Anybody else with some good news? Yes.
So two things. Yesterday, the fourth graders at the Minot Forest School performed at the high school for their winter concert. There were kids from band and also chorus that performed different winter songs. It was an incredible turnout by parents. The kids did just an amazing job. I think they taped it, and that will be sold for a fundraiser. So just look for information on that. The second thing is today at Deacus, they held a student learning expedition, and I was happy to go for the first time ever and hear directly from kindergarteners, first grade and second grade, who had different projects or things that they were interested in, and they were using their presentation skills to come in front of a stranger and be able to tell what they liked about it. We were able to answer questions, and so I think I spoke to probably 10, 11 kids. Every single one of them incredible in their own right, and many, many different talents that are only going to serve Wareham well. So hats off to all of the administration, as well as the teachers and volunteers that participated in that, and I hope that it continues on.
Thank you. I was there as well, and I felt sorry for my kids. They were great, but they were probably, you know, this big stranger in front of them. But they were great. Any other good news? I do want to mention that the fundraiser comedy night that was scheduled for last Friday in the middle of a snowstorm and had to be postponed has been rescheduled for this coming Friday, correct, Rhonda?
Yes.
Still at Salerno's, still 6 o'clock, still should be a great deal of fun. So please come and support both your middle school and high school PTAs and have a good laugh as well. Anything else? Okay. Anything? There was one other thing, but if I remember it, I'll come back to it. Minutes of January 13th.
Move approval.
I have a motion to approve. Do I have a second? Mel, was that a second?
Second.
Okay. Any questions, comments? All those in favor?
Aye.
Oh, sorry. Thank you, Michelle. Roll call.
Aye.
Aye.
Abstain.
Judy?
Aye.
401. Thank you very much. And then the very next day, on January 14th, we had a information meeting attended by Rhonda and myself, but led by the superintendent regarding the possible move of the eighth grade.
And Mel was there too.
Oh, Mel was, sorry, there were three of us there. That's right, it was a full meeting. Yeah. Sorry, Mel. How could we, okay. Which means it was actually opened and adjourned. I want to once again thank all the parents and students who showed up for that meeting. I thought it was very informative, and I hope they felt the same way. So with that, I will take a motion to approve.
So moved.
Second.
And roll call.
Aye.
Aye.
Abstain.
Aye.
401. I think we're up to Dr. Werner.
Hi.
Hi, welcome.
Thank you. Now I have to make sure my PowerPoint opens. It'd be embarrassing, right?
As Dr. Sylvia would remind you that you shouldn't let technology get in the way of a good presentation.
I've been good lately.
You have been good. You have been very good.
Is there a password?
Since I got my smartphone.
You've been quoted more than you've said it.
It's just not weird. Okay. Yep. Sorry.
That's okay.
Now, Linda, your official title is Technology Integration Specialist. Is that a correct? Did I have it correct?
Actually, it's Curriculum Integration Specialist. So
thank you.
So it's really the integration of technology into the curriculum. So that's how the title
we
is.
We ought to get technology into that title somehow. But yes, I got it.
You got it?
The floor is yours.
Thank you. So a couple weeks ago, Chris shared with you about the number of devices that we have in the district, and I was hoping tonight I could briefly share what we're doing with those devices. So I've been on board since August, and I have been around to every school in the district, and my goal was to integrate technology everywhere in the district, a different project at every level. So I want to share a little bit of what's going on. So my goal in my position is to move students in the direction of embracing 21st century skills. And my main focus is communication, collaboration, critical thinking, which are a part of those skills. So I've been looking for projects at all levels that we could work on those. But mostly, my goal is to reinforce tonight that technology is not driving education. Education is driving technology. And how it's integrated into the schools is very important. It has to increase productivity, and it has to be effective. And that's what I'm hoping I'm doing in my role. So at the high school, when I met with them the first time, they shared with me that all the students created portfolios, and they were two gigantic binders by the time that students graduated. So what we've done with the ninth graders is they now have an electronic portfolio. So when they graduate, they will have no binder to take with them, but it will be in their drive, and they'll be able to take that with them. So what they're doing is they are scanning in or uploading from their Google Drive samples of their work across every curriculum area. And we just started that, so right now we have scanned in from science and math and ELA, so the project is just ongoing. It's been phenomenal. The students have really embraced it and are really on board with the technology part. At the middle school, I've been spending a lot of time working on embedded PD, going into classrooms, working on integrating technology. But there is a picture here, and I hope you can see this. This is what I'm most proud of with technology. This is a group of students in fifth grade. I pair them up with students in California and their pen pals. And the pen pals wrote the first letter, the pen pals responded. This is them working, responding to the pen pals. This is a class of about 25 students. There wasn't one sound in the room. There wasn't one discussion in the room. All heads were down, and they were typing for the full class letters to their pen pal. And so I was hoping in that picture you can see the engagement of how they were all focused on that. At mine at Forest, we have some classes that are piloting blended learning. So what they're working on is making the curriculum individualized for all students. So we're piloting one team in third grade and one team in fourth grade, and they've just gotten that started. At Deacus, we have iPads, and that has made a tremendous difference in the learning of the students. So all students in K-1 and 2 are using iPads in small group and in whole class. And it is being used all the time. You can ask Chris about the amount of usage. They are used all day, all the time. I'm also starting blogging with the students because one of my goals is student expression and student ownership of their learning and hearing students' voices. So I've started a blog in grade K-1 and 2. In the beginning, I am generating the question, interviewing students, and typing up the responses. My goal is to have the students take that on, to generate their own questions and type up their own blog, but they're not quite there yet. I also introduced in December the Hour of Code, so all students participated in 1 hour of learning basic coding skills, and that's part of the Computer Science Education Week. It was very successful. They want more coding, and it was very exciting to see little guys embracing coding and understanding in some ways better than me. They were ahead of me, take risks, and they were having a blast with that. The other part of my job, as you can see on the screen, is supporting technology in the district, working with Google Drive, integrating Google Classroom, supporting Lexi, the reading program, Symphony, the math program, working across the board, integrating professional development in all the different grade levels. So I will stop there and open it up for any questions you might have.
Wow, I've never heard such a compact, full of information presentation presented. So you didn't do yourself justice, but I'm sure we have questions.
Thank you.
It was a mouthful. So who would like to start? Go ahead, Rhonda.
Thank you so much for your presentation.
Thank you.
Question that I had has to do with, we hear a lot of chatter when it comes to introducing new technology into the schools but not providing the training that goes along with it. Can you talk a little bit about the plans that you put in place that any new idea that comes into the school has a training plan that goes along with it?
Well, at Deacus, for example, for the iPads, I was so eager to get them into the schools, we didn't really do what I would normally do. So now I'm backing up, I'm going back into the classes. I've already met with the teachers and provided in-service for them on iPads, but now I'm working with the students starting in grade kindergarten, and they will acquire a license for the iPad. And so that will mean they know how to turn it on, turn it off, some of the basic maintenance of that. So my goal is to usually do it beginning of the year, but I was so eager to get so many things going this year that it's been a little bit later. For the Chromebooks, I've worked with the middle school, with the teachers since September. I've done in-service after school every month, a couple of times a month, providing direction on Google Classroom, Google Drive, how to integrate technology. And you're 100% right. It's great to have the devices, but you have to know what to do with them, and the in-service is really important for that.
Right. Especially around the apps that you're kind of throwing out there and things like all of the tool set for Google. I talk a lot about just how to use technology, that it's not only in the classroom, but being able to create that partnership between home and the schools and Google, the Google Suite, is right. Great to do that, especially in the elementary where they don't have power schools, where parents right. Aren't able to log in. So are you also providing best practices, even if they're white papers, on different ways that they can use these things? So basically a yearly technology right. Plan that kind of talks about all the best practices out there.
Well, what I've done, for example, at Deacus, the apps that I put on the iPads, I send out every 2 weeks I highlight one or two apps. And so I highlight what the app is for, how you use the app, how to integrate it into the classroom. Perhaps we could add that to their website so parents would know a little bit more about that. That might be a goal that we have. I'm hoping with the blogging that that would be a way to connect the school to the parents in terms of what's happening with technology.
Okay,
with the middle school, we have the Chromebook Tip of the Week. And every week they have a Chromebook for the teachers to be up on some of the latest apps and what's going on, and hopefully they share that with the students.
Yeah, and the middle school and high school have Power Schools, which are, and automatically
right.
gives parents the
right.
opportunity just for the lower grades.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Cliff, Mel, Judy.
I wanted to know what other staff there was in the schools to support technology. Could you just review that with me?
I'm not sure I understand your question. You mean that...
Helping with the integration of technology. Are there any kind of specialists in the other building, or is it you training the teachers?
At Deacus, there's a computer lab, and there is a paraprofessional there that does work with students in the lab. At Minas Boris, there is a computer teacher that works with the students. Each week, she sees them one time. At the middle school, there is not anyone, so I do a fair amount of time. My time is spent at the middle school.
Okay. And I meant to start off by saying I'm really impressed with what Wareham does with technology, and I'm glad you're here in as the head of it.
Great, thank you.
Mel, go ahead.
I just have one question, and it's been bugging me for quite a number of years, and I brought it up. I kind of bring it up a lot. So for me, it's a passion. We spend an awful lot of money on Power School. And it just seems the Power School is the tool of the high school and the middle school. And I just don't understand why we can't configure our elementary grades to utilize Power School in a variety of different ways. Is that going to be our responsibility with this position?
That's going to be Chris's responsibility.
It's going to be Chris's responsibility?
I'll support Chris on that.
For the sake of me, I just can't understand why at this point in time we haven't utilized Power School at the elementary level. To the point that we should be. Thank you.
You'll be happy to know that Chris was grilled on that subject two weeks ago.
Oh, he was. I'm sorry. Sorry, Chris.
No, I keep going.
There's a great deal of enthusiasm for that happening. Mel, all set? So you've been here since August. Describe a typical week. How do you spend your time?
I have not had really a typical week.
Okay.
I would say a typical week. I try to make sure that I have some project going on at every school, because I want to be present at the high school, the middle school, and both lower schools. So I try to make sure that I'm either doing professional development at one or two schools, I work with teachers in small groups, I have a technology drop-in at the end of the day once a month at Minot. So my weeks are not typical. Some weeks are very heavy on training. Some weeks are very heavy on troubleshooting, making sure that Lexi is working, Symphony is working. So I don't really have a typical week, to be honest. This week I've spent 2 days in early literacy training, so I'm a little focused on that. So I don't really have, I would say, a typical week. All I can tell you is I'm really busy, and I'm driving from school to school, and I'm working with as many teachers as I can. I try to make myself as present as I can in the school, and I want to be in as many classrooms as I can working with teachers, because that's where I think I'm most effective.
You'll be happy to know I've had nothing but positive feedback on your presence in the classrooms.
That's what I want to hear. Thank you.
So thank you for that. I'm sort of an amateur economist. And since the 1990s, which is now closing in on 2 decades ago, the enormous growth in productivity associated with technology has slowed to a crawl. People don't really quite understand why we haven't gotten the benefits of all this technology in terms of productivity, which is a direct link to standards of living. I mean, if you don't get productivity growth, you don't get growth in standards of living, which is a goal for an awful lot of people. My question is, do you think we're at some point in the future we're going to be disappointed with the payback associated with all this technology in education?
I don't think so. I think just the opposite. I don't think we've really begun to see the full impact of technology in terms of education. I think we're just starting. And I'm thinking in terms of engaging students and motivation. I don't think we've really even tapped into what the classroom is going to look like next year, a couple of years from now. It's going to look, if I have my say in Wareham, it's going to look very different. Technology is going to be an everyday part, but a very purposeful, intentional part of the everyday classroom. I think part of what you're saying is that there's not enough training in technology. So people get a device, a new one comes out, they buy something new. They never learn to master the one they have before they get the next one. And my goal is really to have students and teachers master what they have before we move on to something else.
So let's say you're talking to a parent of a kindergartner today, okay? Mm-hmm. How would you describe what the classroom of the high school that that kindergartner is going to experience, you know, 10 years later, how is that going to be different?
That's a very good question. The first thing I would say is that I think that we're moving more toward individualized learning. So that kindergarten student, the time they get to high school, they are not going to see desks in rows. I don't think the classroom will look that way. I think students will work collaboratively, and we don't see enough of that now. And I think the classroom will have technology be such a natural part of the integration of every day that it will not feel like an add-on. And now it still feels a little bit like that. It will be such a natural part of students' everyday life in terms of research and collaboration and communication that the classroom will look extremely different than it does now. My hope is to take those desks out of there and those chairs out of there, put some tables in, because I think that's a more natural way for students to collaborate. So I think that kindergarten student is in for a real treat the time that they get to high school.
And if our student representative is sitting here thinking, I don't think I've ever wanted to be a ninth grader before, but I really love the idea of not having a paper portfolio, would he be able to scan all of his current stuff into some application so that he could turn his current written portfolio into an electronic document?
Sure, he can. The Google site that I created is a template. So he can certainly access that template and create his own Google site. With that, he can scan all his information in with a scanner or with his cell phone. And when he graduates in 12th grade, he will have an external Gmail account, and he'll just transfer everything from the school, from Wareham, to his Gmail account, and that portfolio can go with him. So he can certainly do that.
Up to you, Noah, but if I was sitting there, that's what I would have been thinking.
Yeah. Don't have time. That take years. That now.
Yeah, I hear you. Mel?
I have a couple of comments. The teachers that are being trained in this technology, and I'm thinking more specifically to the high school and having students college ready. Are they in a position to be able to guide students as to what websites are reliable and what websites are not reliable when doing research?
There are several tools that can be used that will vet out the site before you use it and will flag ones that are inappropriate. Whether they're using that or not, I can't say for sure they are. I know I've talked with one history teacher, and we talked about a couple of different ways that you can vet a site before students get on there. But you're right, we have to be careful about that. But I also think that students have to take responsibility to know if they click on a site and it's inappropriate to get off of it. I think that that's called digital citizenship, and so I think that's part of our responsibility to teach students that as well.
I'm not talking necessarily about sites that are inappropriate, but will students be able to discern between sites that appear to be appropriate, but for one reason or another are not truthful?
I would say Minot Forest is doing a great job with that now. They are teaching their students that skill. I do not believe that's being taught at the high school, but I can tell you it's being taught in grades 3 and 4. How to look at a website, how to evaluate whether the website is credible or not, how to look at it and to determine if it's useful to you. I cannot say that the high school is doing that.
My other concern with technology in general, and this is no reflection on those of you who are involved in this to the degree that you are, is that there seems to be kind of a breakdown of interpersonal skills. Because I can look at my computer and I can do all my work on my computer and I don't have to talk to anybody. And that concerns me. Mm-hmm. Because that's what I see happening 20 years from now in a classroom. We don't even need a teacher. All we need is a screen. And I'm concerned that we are undermining the interpersonal skills of students by putting everything in front of them, let them type away to their heart's content, and they'll learn about Googles and they'll learn about blogs and all this. And then they've got to get up in front of a class and they would rather have their knees broken than do that. And I see that as a huge problem.
And I'm going to assume it's okay for me to respectfully disagree with that. Because I look at technology very different than that. I certainly know that technology can be used in isolation. We're teaching our students how to collaborate, how to comment on each other's work, so they're not working in isolation. So I see it a little bit differently. I don't want a bunch of robots just sitting in front of a computer. I don't think that's healthy either. But I don't really think that we're using technology that way in Wareham. I think we're using it for collaboration and communication. So I'm coming from a very different place in what I see.
Okay, thank you.
Can I say one more?
Yeah, just wanted to see if Noah had any thoughts about technology in the high school.
It's definitely useful in collaborating with people, as you're saying. Like, it's projects I wouldn't have been able to accomplish without, in a group, without being able to work through like Google Docs or Google Slides. It's a very good way to get information from you, get edited by somebody at their house, get worked on by somebody that's on break at work. And it's very good in that way. But there's also, like Mr. Lazarus was saying, a couple classes in school where you just, online courses where you're sitting in front of a computer and you're basically just by yourself. It's not like this is a big thing, but there are a few classes like that. And really, I don't think that's, you need that sort of like a human aspect, like with a teacher to keep you engaged, to keep you working. But that, I don't think that's not like the main use of technology. That's a sort of a side.
But that's specifically an online course with no teacher in the
There are some courses like that.
Cliff?
Yeah, you described the classroom of the future. No rows, students engaged with technology, and technology being a seamless part of their student learning. And I think that's probably true. However, I don't think it, I think you may, and it's been my experience, not only as an educator, but a teacher of educators, that these kids are ready. And I think technology is already a seamless part of their education. I think the problem is on the adults. I think the adults haven't accepted technology as a seamless part of the student learning. And because these kids are ready, to give you a perfect example of that, I just got back from Chile and I gave my two grandsons 3,000 pesos. And they were absolutely amazed that I would give them that kind of money, 3,000 pesos. Well, when I was no sooner in the car and got home than one of my grandsons called me up and he says, they call me Pop. They say, hey, Pop. He says, I Googled that. You really didn't give us all that much money. You only gave us about $5. So what I'm saying is these kids don't need to be indoctrinated into the use of technology as far as coping with their student learning. But I really think, and it has been my observation, as I said before, especially when I was doing work at UMass Boston, that it's the adults that are having a hard time with using technology in an integral part of the educational process, the learning process. So I think that's where we've got to focus our energy. Not on the kids. Kids are ready. They're ready.
I agree with you.
And they basically know what they're doing.
Yeah, the kids are definitely risk takers, right. And the adults are coming. It's kind of like learning how to ride a bicycle with an adult. You're going to come
absolutely.
In a very different way.
And I think what's making it clumsy, and I think what's making it probably not as seamless as it possibly could be, is the lack of training on the part of the adults and the lack of time to provide the professional development that we have to do for our teachers. So I don't know how you buy time, but you say you're in the classroom with teachers and so mm-hmm. forth, but bottom line is, these teachers have a lesson to teach, so, you know, they can't abandon that. But, so I think the biggest problem now is the providing quality professional right. development and the time
right.
To infuse that professional development in a cooperative way.
I agree with you that the adults are slower to pick up on some of the new. I also know that a lot of my time is spent in embedded PD and PD, but I can give you just one example. There was a teacher here at the high school, a fifth grade teacher. He has a project in math where they design kitchens. And he's done the project the same way every year. And I happened to be in the hallway and he said, can you just stop and can we talk about the project? And I said, how long have you done the project the same way? He said, every year. I said, do you mind if I make some comments about using Google Drive and can we use Google Drawing and can we change it, can we use Google Classroom? And within about 20 minutes, we had changed his whole assignment.
That's great.
And that's what I'm hoping to do more of. And when he has a problem, he emails me, I respond back to him. And when I look at what has happened just for that one assignment, it just brings a smile to my face because I know the engagement on the student part is going to increase. And I know he now has taken one step further because now he sees the power of that. That's how I think adults yeah. learn and move and change.
Very good. Thank you.
Great story. Great presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Dr. Strom. Oh, and Mr. Palladino, I think you're doing this together, yes? And did I miss someone? Is someone else joining me?
Yes.
I'll sit down here.
Carolyn should be here.
Good evening.
Hi.
We're expecting, I think, one teacher to join us. And she had a parent conference this evening, so she'll be joining us shortly.
A senior class trip parent meeting going on right now at the high school. So Carolyn Gomes is going to be hopefully joining us in the middle of this presentation.
So we're here to talk to everyone about the International Baccalaureate program that we have definitely been researching and highly engaged in for the last year. It's quite an interesting program, and I think that it will deliver basically what our mission statement or vision statement is, and that is that we are to provide challenging, innovative, engaging educational opportunities to create a competitive advantage for our students, our schools, and our community. So in order to address this vision statement, we felt that the International Baccalaureate curriculum would be really a great way to begin that challenge.
So I think it's important to kind of look at some of the buzzwords that they embed into their curriculum. And the students are taught to be inquirers, they're taught to be knowledgeable, thinkers, communicators, principled, open-minded, caring, risk takers, balanced, reflective, all of what we're looking for in the 21st century.
The IB provides a rigorous expectations connected to real world application, which I think is extremely important for our students. It challenges students with an opportunity to think critically about important historic, scientific, and mathematical concepts. It also connects those subjects in an interdisciplinary manner. So in a chemistry class, you'll also talk about history and why the famous people are articulated in certain texts and others left out and what that means and why it's important to know that. I think in one class, they've even questioned Einstein's theories to vet them out a bit, but it's those kind of conversations that are really important. IB fosters student-centered delivery. It incorporates student agency and voice opportunities, producing student-directed work. They get to choose and discuss really interesting topics and exercise control over the aspects of their learning experience. promotes collaboration, communication, creativity, innovation, critical thinking, responsibility, social awareness, and a global perspective that students will need as they persevere in their college career and life. It's open-ended inquiry and project-based learning experiences to ensure that students develop the innovative 21st century skills and the global expertise they will need to compete in college careers and their futures. And in the IB learning experiences are relevant and connected not only to the local community, but also to the state, the nation, and the globe.
So it really provides the students a deeper understanding. There is a different methodology that's used by the teachers. It promotes participation, and there's a lot of support in there for the students. It encourages the teachers and the students to continually to improve, share, collect responsibility, and the teachers and leaders contribute and promote in a results-based collaborative culture that supports high-quality learning for all of our students.
What's really important, I think, for the town of Wareham and what the IB offers the town of Wareham and the students in this town is that it's malleable in that we have the capacity to take the ideas from IB and have them become authentic to Wareham. So I think that's really, really important for a community like Wareham to be able to have that opportunity. It obviously develops some awareness perspectives and a commitment to global engagement. It aspires to empower people, which is another issue that I find really important for the children of Wareham. Provide them opportunities to choose and to find their muse in life so that they can dig in and engage in the things that they're interested in learning about. It also promotes service, community service, a lot of community service. One of the high school components is a CAST project, which is an intensive community service project that includes a lot of writing and reflection, and it's carefully monitored by a teacher. And the rigorous academic choices for the students in creating this competitive advantage is part of our vision and really important for us to look at all of the different areas we can provide for our students to give them advantages.
So we'd be looking for our students in the class 2019 to be able to apply for an IB diploma. So there's an application process. As Dr. Schwamm said, there's a community service process, a project rather, and there's also a reflective essay that's required for the students to graduate. We hope to have a good percentage of the students that participate in the IB classes to graduate with an IB diploma. This would be awarded after the high school diploma, but on the tail end of the summer, approximately in August, they would receive their IB diploma. This diploma is recognized by colleges and universities, obviously in the United States, but also on a global level as well. And I'm going to talk a little bit about what we've done in the high school in regards to this process, because it is quite a lengthy process. And as Dr. Schwamm mentioned, we've been working on this through meetings after school, during school, for about a year, almost a year and a half now. Yeah. And it's been interesting to see the process and see where we started and now where we're heading. We're very excited about where we're heading at this point in time. So we have applied for World School Candidacy. This is quite a process, about a two-year process. We were awarded candidacy in June of 2015. We have begun training and working in concert with our assigned IB consultant who is in charge of a school down in Georgia. We will complete and send out our application for authorization in April 2016. We are anticipating a fall visit next fall for the IB personnel to show up and make a recommendation if we can be an IB school and move away from the candidacy stage. We will offer diploma program in August 2017. This will be when we actually begin the diploma courses. Prior to approval, part of WHS will be required to implement the IB philosophy. So we'll see that happening this year through some training and through some PD, and then we'll actually see it implemented next year in the coursework of our teachers. We have been lucky enough to have some teachers trained, one of which we do hope is going to be able to make it out of that senior class meeting to be here. Unfortunately, the other person had a sick child, but we do have two teachers that are trained. I was fortunate enough to go through the training over the summer, and I know you, on the next slide, we have some middle school folks as well that have been trained.
So to grow that the program, and again, to give us some advantages, we're also looking at the middle years program, which is an IB program that is for students age 12 to 16. Other schools that incorporate the International Baccalaureate, at least in the general area, are only offering the diploma program, and that's for grades 11 and 12, and they do something called pre-IB prior to that. But what we'd like to do is offer the middle years program so that it segues very nicely into the diploma program that the high school has been awarded candidacy for. So we begin that process, which is similar to the diploma process, where an application is filled out and sent to IB in April for the middle years program, and they will let us know whether or not we are in candidacy status in June, similar to the process that happened this year. We've sent four staff members for middle years program training, and we'll be planning, we have another group heading out to do some more training. If we are approved, we will work with I would think the same IB consultant, because she's familiar with the process. She runs both a middle years program and a diploma program in Atlanta, Georgia. So she'll help us as we begin to build units of instruction and the things that are required in order to be considered in middle years program school. And that it's a three-year process. It's a little bit more lengthy because the level of detail that needs to happen in the unit designs is a little bit more rigorous, in that they really have to be teamed up. It's clearly interdisciplinary, and the expectations are just a little bit different than the diploma program. And our goal, if approved, would be we would become a middle years program by IB, in that we don't have to be connected to candidacy status any longer. We could be called in middle years and diploma program. So the diploma program would be first, hopefully in 2018, and the middle years program would follow for 2019.
There are very few schools in the state that are public schools that offer this. You're aware, I'm sure, of Sturgis Charter School. That is the closest school that offers the IB high school diploma. There is also Brockton High School is an IB school as well. Other than that, you need to get into the city of Boston or Springfield to find schools that are approved IB diploma schools. Certainly we'll entertain any questions you may have. Mm-hmm.
Committee. Rhonda, did you want to say something, Kim?
I would, if you don't mind.
Yeah.
Could you just briefly explain why we're looking at the IB program and what we believe it will do for our curriculum and for our students?
Sure. So I think the timing is very important for us, and I think the timing is right now. We have two cohorts of dual enrollment students that are right there, primed for this program, looking for a challenging high school program. Many of those students are now taking sophomore courses as freshmen, and obviously we've got the eighth grade students that are taking the freshman courses as well. So I think we need another venue to challenge these students. We certainly have the AP program, but now to have another venue, to have the IB program, and to have the potential for students receiving an IB diploma, I think that's very important. So I think the timing is right. I think those kids are right there, and they're ready for the challenge.
All set? Rhonda?
Why haven't other schools tackled this yet, public schools?
I really can't speak for that other than to say it requires quite a commitment from your faculty in regards to the training that's required, and it requires someone like Dr. Schwamm to be creative enough to write grants to fund that training. So I think that's probably the largest reason, but I really couldn't speak to it because I've only ever worked here.
I can say that it's definitely a change in the way information is given to students.
It's a different philosophy.
It's a different philosophy, and it's a different pedagogical technique when you're learning to teach that way, because you're actually, there's a lot of planning that happens ahead of time, but the student is no longer a vessel to just take information in, learn that information and know it, and move on from there. They become an integral part in the conversation and the learning process. And so there's you have to let go a bit and provide the right questions that students have an opportunity then to voice the answers to those questions. And it changes the way the classroom works. So it's a little bit scary, I think, for people at first.
Okay. And it's not that I really care what they say, but it's just a question that I think should be asked. What is DESE's recommendation on implementing an IB program within a public school? Do they have one?
They've given us the grants when we've mentioned it, so
okay.
I think they're supportive overall, and they've seen other schools' success, but the level of commitment from the district office to the leadership in the school, the faculty, the school committee, the community, right? I think there has to be that level of support in order for it to work really well.
You mentioned Sturgis. One of the things that I found out was that the Sturgis IB program, they actually have two programs, one that you graduate with an IB diploma, and I don't know what they call it, but it's basically you're going through IB-like curriculum, but you don't graduate with an IB.
Right.
Is that, so if we're similar to the, you know, we have a STEAM program, but it still basically follows, you're still receiving a diploma at the end. If we're implementing an IB program and basically changing the philosophy of how we educate in the high school and soon to be in the middle, are we going to do something similar where we're offering it's still the same philosophy, but if we're going to do this, it's kind of all in, that all students are going to be able to benefit from this, whether they apply
for
the IB.
That's the point.
I anticipate almost at some point in time, we will be pushing every student to take at least one IB course. The difference will be what percentage of students choose to attempt to achieve the IB diploma. And they also have to take a certain number of courses as well beyond that. But I anticipate some year we'll be in front of you saying we'd like to make one IB course a requirement for all students graduating from Wareham High School.
Okay.
But there are two different levels as well. So students can participate at the standard level or the higher level.
That's what it is.
And the higher level coursework is what's required. And you have to take three higher levels for your junior and senior year and the CAS and extended essay. In order to receive your and a certain number on the exam, you have to get a certain score on the exam. I think it's a 3 or 4.
I think it's a 4.
Could be a 4. They score up to 6.
They're a little higher, right?
Okay, but you're seeing a similar model here,
right?
Correct.
Well, right.
Definitely.
Okay.
So, but what happens then? Either way, whether they receive a diploma or not, students are very well prepared, regardless because of the experience.
And the last question that I had is just say it again that that a student, once we get approved for the diploma program,
correct,
they will start taking IB classes once we're approved and it's there.
So
in the ninth, or will it wait, or does it start between 11 and 12?
The diploma program starts in grade 11 and 12, but we will have, whether we have the MYP, the middle years program, or not, we will have like a pre-IB.
Okay.
So the instruction will be similar to what they're going to see junior and senior year. The curriculum will be similar. So we'll have something in place. Hopefully it's the MYP, and that will take care of everything. But if not, we'll have some pre-IB courses for those students. And those start next year for the 10th graders.
Right. And then the middles program, that would be 7th, 8th, or?
It begins in grade 6, actually.
Okay.
And it goes all the way up to grade 10. So it will depend on a number of, you know, just working out the logistics of how that would work.
Okay. Can we just make sure that during this process that we have multiple presentations on this and status and things like that all along the way, because this is the first time that this is being introduced here, sure. And also I think to the community, and I think it's great with something like this to build momentum, as well as make sure that everyone is aware, sure. Every single step of the process, that we keep it front and center here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sure. Great presentation.
Thanks.
Cliff, Mel, Judy?
Cliff? Yes.
Go
ahead, Judy.
Okay, Mrs. Bugin touched on the accessibility for other students. I think it's a very exciting program. I guess I want to start by saying this. But I wanted to know what numbers of the student body, or what percentage do you think would be able to access this program?
I hope it's everyone. It may start off a little small than that, just so we can get this thing rolled out, but I hope at some point to have every student that is enrolled in Wareham High School to have the opportunity to take at least one IB course. But at first, obviously, it will be a little on a smaller scale.
So would it be students who are in dual enrollment more likely, or students who will also take AP courses?
Could be a little bit. It will probably be a little bit of both, but I would venture to say two-thirds of the population would probably be the students in dual enrollment that were in dual enrollment last year.
Okay. But every student would experience the middle years program.
Right.
It's not a choice.
It's across the board.
So the way of learning how to teach and reach students a different way, and the pedagogy that will be infused in all the classes, as do all teachers eventually become trained then in middle school?
Yes.
Okay, that's very exciting.
All set, Judy?
Yes.
Cliff?
Yeah, I particularly am interested in middle years program, because I've seen it work in Boston. And I think that what it does is it provides an attitude on the part of the student body towards a little self-pride and basically self-direction, and being really critical thinkers. So, and I think Mr. Palladino made mention of the fact that the timing is perfect. I think the timing is perfect to start this program now, especially with the possibility we may have a five-year high school. So I think that all of the cards are sort of falling in place right now. And my advice is full steam ahead. I've seen it work in Boston. It's a great program. And I think it's really good for the kids, and it's another outlet in which they can build self-confidence and pride, not only in themselves, but also their school. Mm-hmm. And I think that's so important about the school culture.
Definitely.
So kudos to the work that you've already put in, and my advice is put the pedal to the metal and let's get going.
Will do.
Thank you.
Mel? All set?
Yes, sir.
Noah?
Just a quick question.
Sure.
Is there, for each IB course, a sort of, AP has it, like an end-of-year test that all
Correct.
Culminates to?
Yes, these students won't miss out on that opportunity. They'll have an end-of-the-year exam, very similar to the AP style, a little different scoring, but same idea, and then we do send those out just like the AP tests.
And you said you needed two or three of those courses to get the diploma?
Three high level and two standard level minimum. Most kids will take more than that during the 2 years, but the HL courses are traditionally 2 year courses.
All right, and they'd have to pass each test in order to be able to get the diploma?
Correct.
All right.
Thank you.
Okay, so I've been on the committee for about a decade, and even though this is being presented as just, another program, my sense is, and I don't believe in hyperbole, but my sense is that this is the biggest deal that has been presented to this school committee in a decade or more.
This is good.
Is that a fair statement?
This is a really big deal.
This is a big deal, right? Scott, you agree? You've been around a long time. It's
a huge deal. I think this could really change the direction of Wareham High School.
And for that matter, the middle school.
Eventually,
absolutely.
The middle school, absolutely. It's
okay.
Just going to be a year or two behind.
I understand. And when I looked at this calendar, it looked like we started out a year behind with the MYP, But then we ended up 2 years behind. Is that because?
No, that we didn't. We're actually on time, but the process, we spoke to the consultant.
But it's more rigorous process?
It takes an extra year. As a result of our discussion with the consultant. So even though program is less time, this takes a little bit more time.
And remember, how many teachers need to be trained for that program versus the high school program?
Understood.
So you need that extra year, trust me.
Now, in your opening slide, you talked about a competitive advantage. My sense is that this is not only a very relatively rare program defined in the Commonwealth and maybe even across the country, but it's exceptionally rigorous, and that a college application with this on it would be a big advantage. Is that, am I overstating it?
Not at all. And the call, a lot of the, most of the colleges are going to offer college credit for these courses with the appropriate score on the high, the AHL course.
Similar to the AP.
Exactly.
But the difference is, because of MYP, kids will be even better prepared to succeed in their junior and senior year and obtain the special diploma, rather than being hit with AP courses and like, whoa.
Correct.
Now, if you're
which is the plan. I mean, we want, if we can set everyone up appropriately when they're younger, then that would give more opportunity for other students that would might not otherwise participate to participate and do so in a way that's effective.
When I looked at your description of what this was like, what it would, how it was different than standard education, it was, I looked at it and I thought, what's not to like?
Right.
I mean, there's really, I didn't see any downside, but let's be really critical. If you're a parent of a elementary school kid or an early middle school, and you're anticipating this happening, or if you're a student, okay, and you're aware of this, because I think my colleague is right, I think we need to give ongoing updates of our progress towards this really momentous effort. What would you say to a parent and a student about how it will feel different than perhaps when that parent went to Wareham High School or Wareham Middle School? What will be different?
I don't think you're going to see traditional teaching that's going to be out the door. You're going to see a lot of debates. You're going to see a lot of hands-on project-based learning. You're going to see a huge infusion of technology, not only into the instruction, but into the way the students respond. It's just going to be a total shift from what has been going on in education for the last, you know, 30 years.
There should be really interesting dinner conversations.
I used to have them when I was a child.
When they get home and they talk about something that happened in history, for example, that they felt compelled, that actually made them feel something, right? That they became emotional about. That those are the kind of conversations that you hope to inspire in students. When they go home, they have an opportunity to talk to their families about that experience.
So, for example, what my father used to do to me all the time at dinner tables, the Socratic seminar,
correct,
would become routine,
correct,
and then carried on to the dinner table.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Okay, so let me put on my skeptic hat. How many places have become candidates and then failed in the implementation of this?
I tried to find that online, and ironically, it's not publicized, so I would be guessing.
That would make me doubly interested.
I'd be guessing. I know I had an opportunity to go to training in July in New York City, and there were four schools that were candidacy schools, and they had their principal or their headmaster there, and they had about 14 that were already involved. Some of them have been involved for as many as 20 years. Of the four that were there, they're all four are moving forward with their candidacy. So that's kind of the only piece of evidence I can pass along to you that I have.
Of the classroom teachers that have been trained, did they come back skeptical, enthusiastic, something in between?
Enthusiastic. They were emailing me after the first day saying, when are we starting this program? And I had to kind of say, easy, we were just a candidate school at this point in time. So it's going to be a couple of years, but you know, learn as much as you can, bring back whatever you can. And they both, first day back, came back to my office and said, all right, we really need to know, when are we getting this started? And I said, well, this is, you know, I gave them the time frame that we gave you, and they are extremely excited. We have a few other teachers we obviously need to get trained, and that's going to happen in the spring. And, you know, I can't wait to see those folks come back. And, you know, we start to get 7 or 8 professionals excited about what's going to be happening next year and in the future. It should be an interesting time at Wareham High School.
Mr. Palladino was very excited after he came back from training in July.
I was skeptical when I left, and, though.
Right.
Skeptical when you went to it, but not yep. when you returned.
Correct. And I think a certain department head was passing along information that I was really enjoying the training and thought it was something we needed to do. But I was unsure going in, and I was definitely drinking the Kool-Aid when I left.
So when, so to finish up my comments and questions, every student who wants to be a part of this, well, it will be available to them.
Correct.
And at some point, it's essentially going to be part of the experience, and every student will be exposed to it, whether they like it or not, in a sense.
I hope to get to a point where we have trained every teacher in this methodology so that even if they're not teaching an IB course, they're embedding it into their instruction, their curriculum, and utilizing the skills that they learn. Hopefully, best case scenario, every teacher does teach an IB course, or maybe even multiple IB courses, but that's really the goal, you know, 5-6 years down the road.
We're also looking at the primary years program too, but we need to get through this first. Like, there's just a lot on our plates, but that's another, I did send some people for an overview training on that program as well.
So. I'm officially excited. When do you think you should give the next update?
I would think
in the fall. It'd be great if the teachers could be here.
We could do something in the spring with the teachers, but definitely I think an update is due in the fall to let you know if we have been approved to be the diploma program.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Can I make a recommendation?
Please.
Because there's so much going on in the school system and the teachers that have not been, that have been trained, couldn't be here tonight. I would love to hear a presentation directly from them of
sure.
the teachers that have gone through it and how they feel this is going to change what their day-to-day world will be like in the classroom.
Sure.
That would be great.
If we can get a few more teachers trained, I think that would be definitely be appropriate.
Madam Superintendent, let's plan for something in the spring.
Definitely. Well,
and then would you like to introduce our IB coordinator?
Absolutely.
Okay.
All right. So we're fortunate enough to have our coordinator here. Ashley Yates has been recommended and approved to be the coordinator of the IB program. Ashley is no stranger to Wareham High School. She's filled in for the Dean of Students position when we had a maternity leave. She has subbed for us in various short and long-term positions. And she comes to us from Vermont, where she was a department head for English. She's a certified English teacher, and she is very close to receiving her certification in Massachusetts as a principal, assistant principal, and she holds that license in Vermont as well. So, Ashley, come on up, since you're hiding in the back.
Ashley, welcome.
Thank you.
Is there anything you'd like to add?
I think we're all just generally excited to implement this program. It's gaining a lot of steam nationwide, and I think it'll be a real benefit to the community.
So the question that Mr. Palladino didn't have an answer to about failures and number of places around the country that are doing this, do you have any data that you can share with the committee about that?
I don't at this time.
Okay, that's fine. Okay. That's fine. Okay.
Because we will not be a failure.
Can I say one more thing?
Please, go ahead.
It's not an option.
Yeah. Somebody asked a question, I don't know, but it's something just popped into my head because I've got limited experience with it, but you know, they've met with some success in Boston and with IB schools. But if I were to describe the change in atmosphere, it would be on the part of the students, instead of being passive participants in their learning, they're active participants in their learning. Not only are they active participants in their learning, but they're also active participants in classroom operations. And that is very, very important. The entire structure of the classroom changes, mm-hmm. and it becomes a unit. teachers, coach, and students as learner and also manager of the classroom. So the whole atmosphere on that is totally different in terms of how the students see their own role. And if I were to put it in a nutshell, I think that that's the way I would describe it from my observations.
I see a lot of nodding heads. I think you succeeded.
That's a very nice job. It's true. It's a very good observation.
It's kind of what we see all the time in the DECA classrooms. You know, it's very similar, and obviously, take a guess who's in line to be trained. Some of the business teachers are very excited about this model as well.
Oh, great. That's good. Yes. That's excellent. Thank you.
I think we're done and excited. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We have three policies, which are new policies, for our consideration. Kim, you want to take us through them?
Sure, we'd be happy to. The first
question, one
before
second.
Before we start.
Yes.
Have these been approved by the Policy Review Committee?
That's a great question. New policies come to us first.
All right, okay.
Yes.
So they haven't seen these yet?
They have not.
Okay, thank you.
The first one is the prohibited bullying policy. We had our attorney review this. This is what we need to have on file per our CPR, and so I would ask for your review and your approval.
Comments, questions? Mel?
This meets state law.
Yes.
Thank you.
Anybody else?
Was some of this boilerplate?
Some of it was boilerplate, but it was also then adjusted by our attorney.
Okay.
So I have a question. Mm-hmm. I was really interested when I started reading this, how they were going to deal with the off-site bullying. So whatever that is, two little eyes, the second paragraph on the first page where it starts out at a location, activity, function, or program that is not school-related, and then it goes on to describe the fact that if it infringes on the rights of the victim at school, even though the bullying didn't occur at school, but the two students are in the school, it could theoretically create a hostile environment. And I thought, that's clever language. I can see how that's relevant and appropriate and needs to be in here. Then I went further down and towards the bottom.
What page?
I'm trying to find it. I was trying to mark up this, which didn't work all that well. But then it starts to talk about what happens. The problem became of, yes, then we have a reporting responsibility, okay? And the reporting responsibility basically says that if two students do something, say in the mall, one student bullies somebody in the mall, and one student goes to one school district and the other student comes back to our school district, we now have a reporting responsibility to that other school district about an incident that occurred in the mall, for example, even though there is no hostile environment and the two students don't meet in our school district. And that seemed to me to be beyond the scope of our responsibilities. And I'll defer to my colleague, Mel Lazarus, who's an attorney. Do you see my point?
I do, and to me, this is similar to 51A reporting, that even though these two people may never meet again.
Right.
If a student comes to a teacher or an administrator, I think that it's incumbent upon that teacher to report what he or she has been told by the student. It's incumbent upon that teacher to report it to an administrator. if for no other reason that then that we can put the proper authorities on notice. Now, may never happen again. They may never meet again. In non-legalistic terms, we're covering ourselves and not opening up any possibility of those two people meeting again and having a similar situation.
So is the difference that in one case, if it's the same school, two kids from the same school district, we have an investigatory responsibility?
This is a reporting.
This is just
no
a reporting. Just no
reporting.
Investigation.
Right.
Okay. I can buy that. Are we all on the same page?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Mel. I
You're
appreciate
welcome.
The distinction. All right. Anything else on bullying?
No.
Yes.
If it follows the law, and that's fine, and I read it over, and it's really, in terms of complying with these standards, this is big. I'm glad I'm not an assistant principal or principal anymore. But the only thing that bothers me, and I guess I can't really comment on it because if it's the law, it's the law, is with the use of technology and cyberbullying. You know, I mean, if this is happening in someone's living room and the kids are bullying one another in their living rooms, you know, and yet we're bound to inform the authorities or to do an investigation.
Only if it's in the same school district.
Well, yeah, they're going to be probably in the same school district. So, you know, does anyone reasonably think that this isn't going to be a Pandora's box in terms of how we have to respond to this, even though the offense didn't happen at school? And I know it's all moot because the law is the law is the law, but it's going to be incredibly time consuming.
No,
we've already dealt with situations like that. Before I retired, we dealt with situations like that. And we take the same investigation reporting procedures as we would if it was a face-to-face confrontation.
Yeah, I understand.
What students do at 2 o'clock in the morning between themselves, we have no control over unless that activity causes a disruption within the school, in which case we're bound by school and law to do something about it.
Right.
I mean, the word that got me was, I can easily see that 2 a.m. conversation creating a hostile environment in the school after the 2 a.m. conversation, and that makes it our problem, whether we like it or not.
No, I understand, but I just think that this is huge.
It is huge.
But we have to do it. I understand the law is the law. But it's huge.
But like anything else.
But Cliff, you're right. It is a Pandora's box.
Well, it means that parents and teachers and school administrators have to work together to keep it as infrequent as possible.
Good luck to that.
I don't think we have a choice. I'll take all the good luck we can get.
Is a motion?
We haven't got a motion yet, but I will take one.
To approve this, and then does it go to the...
No, it doesn't.
But
it will be reviewed again within 3 years, 5 years.
Well, I would make the motion if it got reviewed by the Policy Review Committee now to make sure that, because, I mean, I read it over, but I would really appreciate if there's 10 people on the Policy Review Committee, if they could just peruse it to see if there's anything that stands out and bothers them.
Well, we have the chairman of the Policy Review Committee here. I think
your colleague
would like it reviewed sooner
rather than later.
Well, I don't
know what their timeline is.
And we don't really have any choice.
Michelle, when's the next meeting? Whether we peruse this and question it or not is basically irrelevant.
Okay.
It's state law. And my feeling is if our attorney has molded this to fit the state law, and the state law on bullying and harassment is in our handbook.
It is. Okay.
What's interesting is the punishment, the discipline associated with breaking this is really in the hands of the principals.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's a lot of verbiage here, but in the end, what happens as a result of the investigation is really up to the principal, and by that, and the handbook, which is a guide. Okay, I'll take a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Any further comments or questions? Okay, roll call, please.
Yes.
Yes.
Cliff?
Yes.
Judy?
Yes.
Yes, 500. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. The next one is security cameras in the school. We have security cameras in our school and have for a good period of time. This policy just acknowledges that fact and makes the statement that they are authorizing the use of cameras to ensure health, welfare, and safety of all students and staff, et cetera, et cetera. So I would ask for approval of this policy.
Comments, questions? This is another mask policy, I guess?
Yes.
Okay. Then I will ask for a motion, please.
So moved.
Second.
Roll call.
Second. Yes.
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 Cliff?
Yes.
500. Thank you. Next.
The next one, emergency plans. This is also a mask policy. It cites legal references and it also outlines the planning for emergency and disasters. It's essential for the safety of our students and staff. It just provides the substance of our emergency plans. So I'd ask for a motion for this policy.
Questions, comments? Yes, Cliff.
The only question I had or comment was when I read this over, and if this is right out of the law, that it's the law is the law is the law, but it said in the second paragraph, the superintendent will develop and maintain plans. Well, I don't think our superintendent is going to develop emergency plans. I think we're going to have a committee of emergency personnel that's going to develop the plan. So I could see the superintendent making sure that these plans are developed, but in terms of the superintendent actually develop them, I have a problem with that verbiage.
We do have emergency plans developed, and we review them regularly.
Right, but does the superintendent actually develop them?
No.
Then,
of course
then
not.
That verbiage is probably not accurate.
The only thing I would say
Mr. Chair?
Yes, go
it's
ahead.
It's okay. Go ahead.
The only thing I would say is it says we'll develop in consultation with.
No, that says that's in paragraph 3.
Yes.
All right.
So that's how I got comfortable because okay. Your point is well taken.
Yeah, but
so
that, I think
in
you
the
just...
End, in the end, the superintendent is legally responsible as the CEO of the school district. She can't really delegate it.
Right.
Anyway.
Well, then you put the superintendent is responsible for maintaining plans, da-da-da-da-da. So it doesn't matter. It's a small point.
Okay. Anything else? No.
Does this conform to that flip chart of emergency plans that we've had in place for some time?
Yes.
Thank you.
I'll take a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Roll call.
Yes.
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 500. Thank you very much. Acceptance of gifts.
Yes, I would ask for acceptance of a monetary gift of $1,300 from Jeffrey Sweat to the Wareham Public School ASLP Scholarship Fund.
So moved.
Second.
The only thing I'll say about this is I do this on an annual basis. I think the ASLP program is an outstanding opportunity. We have 18 slots that are, I believe it's eighth graders, are eligible, and we haven't always used all 18. I think it's, I hope we can do this. I think Mrs. Rossi, before she went to the high school, did a great job with this. I think Mr. Bissonnette, I believe is his name, is doing a great job. In fact, he had a parent meeting to encourage people to apply. And it's has natural synergies with the STEAM program. So to all you parents out there, especially those that have kids interested in the STEM program, please apply, and I hope you take advantage of a great program at the Mass Maritime Academy. I'll take a motion.
You already got it.
Oh, sorry. Roll call?
Yes.
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 500. I guess I should abstain. 401, sorry. Yes. Mr. McMillan and Mr. Tatro, welcome. This is quite a document.
Good evening.
Excuse me?
Good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you.
It's still quite a document. Are you going to really show all this? It's an eye test, too.
What I am going to do, though, is take you through some slides, which take you through the document. Now, the slides just reiterate what was in the document, so it's not new information. So the slides weren't in your pack, so I beg your indulgences to allow us to show this. So this has been a little bit of a labor of love for me. I've worked with Mr. Tatro, our operations manager, to develop a list of all our capital improvement and capital needs. I think what's been most important about this is having a process to conduct a review of our buildings on an annual basis to identify all our needs, to prioritize those needs, identify the funding for them, and start to allow us to focus on what needs to be done. It's a bit like, you know, because, you know, it can be a bit overwhelming looking at all the building needs we have, and this is identifying it so we can get started, or, you know, make sure we're focused.
Do your wife and kids know that this is a labor of love?
I don't share everything with them. it's very time consuming, this sort of work. It requires walking around every building, and it really has been the appointment of Mr. Tatro to the operations manager that's allowed us to get a lot of this work done. So I'm going to pass over to Jeff now to take us through the sort of some of the process for this work.
Yeah, the objective of this capital improvement plan is to create a logical, transparent, and comprehensive strategy to address the district's capital needs. And this is done through a lot of research on how we're going to try to develop how we can prioritize the needs of the schools. So we have to develop a facilities condition review, which involves walking around the building with the head custodians, kind of going over each individual room, each individual problem at the school, and then documenting all that information. Now we'll update this information on a year-to-year basis over the summertime. And then we'll review it with the business manager and the principals to make sure we keep going in the process, and we update this living document. So whatever's on the list now, we'll close some and we'll add some more in the future. And then with the business manager, we need to develop the funding for the project and then ultimately submit a plan to the town or to the school, how we're gonna get this process done. So how did we develop a priority score? How did we determine what the priorities should be? So we had to look at the likelihood of failure times the consequences of failure. So the likelihood of failure, it's graded 1 through 10. 10 being where the component doesn't work anymore, and essentially 0 is where it's brand new. And then the consequences of failure, we had to factor in a few different factors. Health on impact and safety, school operations, future expenses if that component should go, and as well as if it's in line with the district vision. So that was rated on a scale of 1 to 10 to 1, again, where 10 has a severe impact on one of those categories. You know, health and safety has a severe impact, or no impact would be a 0. So I think we have an example just to give us how it was done. So we just picked a random project, the boiler at Deacus Elementary School. And this is how we graded it. And since it's a weighted scale, 3 times on health and safety, twice on impact of school operations. So everything kind of got multiplied by what we felt was a priority. And I think you can look at how this overall was graded to give us a priority score of 203. So we take every identified problem and give it a priority score, and then put those in order as to where our projects should be ranked.
So thank you very much. So that's the process we went through with all the items identified and are in that the document you've received. So the second part was then to identify, the next part was then to identify the possible funding. So a lot of the smaller items were immediately identified as to be pursued through our operating budget. But the top priority funding requests that we have made as a result are these listed here. So this reflects information in your document as well. And these are the ones we've taken to the Town Capital Planning Committee to seek town funding outside our operating budget to pursue in the coming years. These also, the first four items here actually are also ones which came out of our operating budget. If you remember, as the budget, one of the steps in the budget process was to identify items which really could be undertaken as capital. So the total was just big enough, or we could combine multiple projects into one. So that's why we have technology up there, you know, completing the work we've already undertaken with rolling out additional technology devices, significant HVAC repairs and upgrades, particularly the middle school and the high school, replacing fixtures and furniture again, that's the high school and at DECUS, and instructional materials, textbooks and curriculum materials. Those are the first four, and the last one was the new dump truck with plow, which we need, and was really exposed at the last storm. We were able to, the fields and ground staff did a great job, but they're really labouring with insufficient vehicles. So I'm not going to go through all those items. They're on that list. They're also in the document received. There was additional priority projects, but where we have our potential funding has been identified. So the DECUS boiler, the example we used, that has been funded at the moment through a project with MSBA. So that's replacement of the boiler at DECUS and the partial roof replacement. We're looking at mine at forest renovation. So a lot of items which relate to mine at forest are not on that list at the moment because we're hoping to pursue them through an MSBA grant, and actually is the next agenda item. And also we need to replace a number of school buses, and the town's been has helped to secure an EPA grant that will help to fund replacement of buses as well as town borrowing. So I just wanted to highlight those. So that is the end of our slides.
Ready. Any questions?
Yes, please.
Questions? Mr. Lazarus is shaking his head. Go ahead.
No, I'm just...
I'll take that as a silent comment, Rhonda.
Yes, please.
I think for many years in the district, there's been just this feeling when it comes to anything being fixed in the districts and the buildings, and it's felt by teachers, by administration. It's been happening for years. How is this process being communicated with our staff so then they know that there will be, not could anymore, but will be a light at the end of the tunnel, that we have a true plan to be able to start knocking off some of the major issues in our capital needs?
So I mean well, I felt exactly the same way as that when I started, was just that, you know, that difficulty in grasping everything we needed to do, and that's, you know, part of the impetus for this project. The next step, you know, the hard bit is, particularly with the smaller stuff, is actually through that gets funded through the operating budget, and that it depends on what our final budget is. So there is the next phase in this is really making sure we get that funding, and also being able to, and one of the reasons I like having this document is it captures what you're, you know, if we decide not to do something, if we don't get a sufficient budget to do something, we're able to capture what, you know, what is the cost of our choices. So that's a long, so we haven't communicated this out to staff yet. And really that will be a process which, once we have our budget approved, my intention is to work with the principals to identify which of these, you know, this is the plan, which with the budget you have, which of these will you now be able to tick off? And then that's the process which would go to staff.
So my only recommendation is that the process that you've created
Yeah.
never been done here.
before. So meaning that the amount of time that went into the documentation and how you're going to calculate and how you're going to take a look at what the highest needs are. Even that piece alone, mm-hmm. I think, is important to get out there so then that they know that as a district, we're working on it. When it comes to the funding sources, that is at the end. But at least the process that the district is looking at it and has a plan once the money comes.
Yep.
So I think that sooner than later would get us even a little bit further.
Well, I'd be interested. And it leads to some very interesting conversations because when you see the scores that some items get, it makes you really think about why we think it's a priority. And, you know, that get into, like, why do we choose one thing over another? And it really exposes our underlying assumptions. So
the only other question I have has to do with you're only receiving information from the custodial staff when it comes to the capital needs, or is it a work in progress within the buildings that then that information gets bubbled up? Because my husband and I have very different priorities when it comes to the capital needs in my household, so I can only imagine all the different opinions of the capital needs.
Mr. Tedrow met with the head custodians, and we also had meetings with the principals. So there is, I think you're right, there is an opportunity to expand our consultation and involve teachers. Okay. I think would be an improvement. You know, to be honest, this process, like you say, is new, and we are still, there are things I want to do to improve the process, and I think that's one of the things we can do.
Okay, thanks. That's great.
Cliff?
Good job.
Judy?
It's very comprehensive, and I tried to look at everything, and one thing that's number one, priority 101, and it was install ADA compliant doorknobs to all internal doors.
Yep.
If it's ADA required, why would it be so low? If it's ADA required, something like that. That's my question.
All right, I'll hand over that to Jeff.
Number 101.
So 101.
101, page 3.
Yeah, so I think, I'm gonna answer it in general terms, which is I think it slightly reflects the needs of the district. So there are some things, so those doors, the door handles are working, whereas there are other things which just are not working, which have to be repaired ahead of them. So, you know, it really reflects the priorities. You know, the score we gave that, it was a low likelihood of failure because those doorknobs are there and working. And so other things came ahead of it. Also, there is a Minot Forest project, so it's also in one of the ones we're on hold while we look to see if that gets funded through the MSBA.
Oh, through the MSBA.
Yeah. That doesn't affect the rating, but it does affect whether or not, you know, where it appears on our scale.
We're also grandfathered in.
Yeah, oh, thank you. Yes, that as well. Yes.
Yeah, my understanding that what that really means is if you decide to replace them, then they have to be ADA compliant.
Yeah.
But until you replace them, you're grandfathered.
Which doesn't mean we shouldn't actually do it. It's just mm-hmm. that it affects where that influences these scorings.
So I have a nasty question. Okay. There are two ways to put this together. One way is you know what the results you want, so you make sure the score comes out to match what you want to happen.
Yeah. Okay?
And the other is to ignore all of the outside influences and simply go by the very logical process and then hope that it comes out the way you wanted it to come out. Which is the better way to describe what actually was done?
Some combination of the two.
Some combination of the two.
Because there is it's not like there is some objective criteria which is the right objective criteria. So really there is a process by which we identify, we come up with some weightings, we apply those to these. I mean, we did this a couple of times where we come up with, we scored everything, we applied a formula, and then you would see that some things which we know is a priority did not come out close to the top. So you think, well, why is that not appearing in the top? And it's because we're not, you know, giving enough weight to health and safety. So you increase the weight in health and safety, and then you look at the report.
Make it come out the way you wanted it to.
A little bit. For the ones, well, no, it's more like you have, we're able to look at certain, because we don't, I mean, to be honest, we haven't, you know, there's so many here, you can't legislate for every single one of them. but you can identify some which appear in the wrong place, and so you adjust the formula for that, and then you get a sense that the overall priority list is the right one.
So I'm old enough to remember a very famous commercial, which is basically pay me now, pay me later, i.e. Yeah. change your oil filter or have the engine fail, right? So my question is, the two components to the formula, which make perfect sense, don't seem to include the cost of repair associated with a failure, which should have some influence on how you rate the importance of that particular need, shouldn't it?
So, I'm not sure I totally...
Health and safety is one thing.
Yeah.
So current condition is another piece. But what it will cost you if you don't replace
it? So the future expense is supposed to capture that. So, for example, with the boiler, the fact that running an inefficient boiler will continue to cost us is supposed to be reflected in the score that gets for future expense.
Not quite the same thing, but I understand what you're saying. So I think that's a third piece I would make sure is captured. For example, what it would cost to repair something if it truly broke and was not functioning might be really high.
Yeah.
even if it was well maintained. But okay. I thank you for your efforts. Sorry, Cliff, go ahead.
Could I just ask one quick question?
Sure.
Of course.
You made me think of it. And it was a very, very good point that you made. So basically, my question is this, and this is ballpark, Mr. McMillan.
Yeah.
Of all of those priority line items, what percent of those priority line items did you apply this fudge factor? I'm just curious, you know, about 10%, 15%?
There's no fudge factor. Once we came up with the formula, is something that will probably come back to
kind of manipulated is what I'm asking.
So I think I'm giving the wrong impression because it's not quite, manipulation's not right. We worked with the formula until we came up with a formula that we felt best reflected the needs of the district.
Okay. And we applied all of those line items, what percent was
none.
That?
None. Well, but I mean, it is a subjective process. So scoring the impact on health and safety of failure is, I mean, like, it's subjective.
Okay, I'm putting you on the spot.
We fudged none of them. So once we came up with the formula, it was applied to all of them, and the results were what they were.
But you readily admit that after you applied the formula, the number didn't come out the way you wanted it to.
While we were developing the formula. Once the formula was settled.
Oh, I understand. Okay. And so you applied the same formula consistently after you manipulated.
Yes.
Okay,
so
gotcha.
next year is when we'll be fudging. No, I'm not kidding. But next year is when we'll have the challenge because the formula's set.
Right. So, and the only reason I ask the question is because my chair progged my brain.
Yeah, and Mr. Chair,
and
the
I'm
thing
dying
is
to
that
figure out what Michelle writes down about.
Yeah, I know. And the thing is, at the end of the day, there are so many capital needs in this district that it's all subjective because there are so many high needs and safety that get to have that conversation about how the formula and how strong it is once we have a smaller amount of capital needs. That's not the factor
which
today.
Which is precisely why your colleague sitting next to you had a facial comment rather than a verbal comment.
Thank you, Mr. McMillan.
Right. I would just say, so the other thing is to say, this list is a starting point. If I go to a principal and they say, oh, no, that's wrong, this is a priority for me, then they'll have to defend it.
But with the formula that you created.
Yeah, and they'll have to, you know, if they want to move something, they'll have to make a case based on these factors.
Good job. Good job.
It is an excellent job, and I'm very glad you have made it a labor of love. Anything else?
Mm-mm.
Okay.
Nothing could be added to that.
The warrant article, which you're also handling, Mr. McMillan?
Yes. So actually, there's two warrant articles.
Actually, there's two.
Thank you, Mr. Pedro.
Yes. So.
Thank you, Jeff.
Both articles relate to MSBA projects. The first I want to address is for the John Deakis Elementary School boiler and partial roof replacement article. So, as you may recall, And with MSBA projects, there's two phases. There's a feasibility study phase, and then there's an actual construction phase. So with DECIS, we had a approval to enter into the feasibility phase, so that is currently underway. We do not have the results yet, but we are hoping, or we, the plan is that we will be ready to move to the construction phase in time for April town meeting. So we would like to get to April town meeting approval to appropriate the funds necessary for the construction phase of that project. So the articles have to be submitted by February 1st. So it's we're a little ahead of ourselves because we don't have the results of the feasibility study, but we want to make sure we don't miss our window to get onto town meeting agenda.
Understood. So you'd like a vote for approval of this warrant article?
Yes, please.
Okay. Now, as I recall, the other one, not all the blanks were filled in, but this one has all the blanks filled in.
No, this one actually doesn't have the blanks, because this one is the...
I have them.
Yeah.
Okay, so the motion is when things get really specific.
So you actually don't have to read this motion?
Well, my point is,
yeah.
We can. Will we have all of the specifics available by April town meeting?
Yes.
We will.
Yeah.
Okay. Fine. So the basic article is really all we're approving at this point.
Yeah, and you're just really giving me the...
Okay. Any questions on the article? Not the motion, but the article.
Which article?
This is the DECIS boiler and partial roof
replacement.
Okay.
And I have seen the roof up close and personal.
Yeah.
And the boilers deserve to be in the Smithsonian.
Yeah.
And I would say the MSBA representatives were sufficiently impressed
definitely
with the condition of these items.
Move approval on the article.
Second.
Roll call.
Yes.
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 500. Thank you very much.
So Minot. The second article is for Minot Forest Elementary School. So the MSBA Board of Directors met today. And one of the items on their agenda was to invite the town of Wareham into the MSBA's eligibility period for their core program, which is for renovation or rebuild of schools. And that's for Minot Forest Elementary. So we don't have the formal invitation yet, but we are expecting it very soon. And it would be in time for us to seek approval at the April town meeting for funding for the feasibility study of the to renovate, rebuild, or other options related to Minot Forest Elementary School. So again, we've got this window. We have to get in by 1st of February, so coming for your approval to do that.
So before I ask for a vote on this, and maybe this question is both to you and the superintendent, have there been any recent discussions about the global view of elementary education in Wareham and where it would take place long term?
Yes, part of this feasibility study would be to look at if we would have one elementary campus, if we would just renovate or rebuild Minot. It looks at grade configuration. This study would look at all elementary programs to come up with the best possible scenario. And this is a little bit different of a study than what has been offered in the past, because this study allows us that flexibility to do so. What this study will also do, it looks at grade configurations, it looks at renovations, it looks at replacement, it looks at the whole process for our elementary, and then we will be making a recommendation. We need approval for town meeting, of course, to move forward with this feasibility study. The feasibility study also includes the planning, getting ready to go out for bid. It will give us the actual price. When we came in for DECIS, we're at 78% reimbursement. 68. And the feasibility study for Minot is also fully reimbursable, depending on the percentage. So we feel...
Not fully, partially.
Right, partially on the percent that we're reimbursed.
So this particular feasibility study could just be a renovation of Minot, or it could be a replacement of Minot,
or it could even be the creation of an elementary school campus, if you will, for all grades K through 4.
Yes.
And that has not been decided or anything else, but the town is willing to look at that as a concept.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Questions about that, either on a micro or macro level? Okay, I'll take a motion.
I move approval on the feasibility study for our Minet article.
Second.
Roll call.
Yes.
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 Yes, 500. Superintendent's report, is that correct?
Yes. Very briefly tonight, we've been working with the town on our FY17 budget. We certainly appreciate the willingness of the town to work collaboratively together, and we're moving forward to resolve any concerns or issues that we have. We feel very good about the place that we're at this point. As you know, we were invited into the MSBA study today for the Minet. The official date for us to come in will be in March, and that will start our time clock in March, so that gives us a little bit of a head start as far as we get ready to prepare to bring forth information. I would certainly invite any parents or community members who have questions or would like to be part of our group to examine this to please contact me. We're looking to form some committees and have some forums to have this discussion. You also have in your packet a very draft copy of the school calendar for FY16-17. Have they received that one yet?
No.
Okay. No. Okay.
We
so
got the amended one.
All right. So we've been looking at the draft calendar for FY17. We will be bringing it forward to you in probably the March meeting. I've received some input from teachers. I've received input from parents, and we're looking to see what adjustments we should be making on our calendar, and the union is looking at it as well. The adjustment that you have in front of you on the FY15-16 calendar would be the dates in bold on the MCAS. The state changed some dates, so we've just merely reflected it on the calendar for your information.
So just the bottom section.
Yes, just the bottom section.
Because there are bolded vacation and holidays and things, but that's
yes.
The same.
Okay. That's correct. That's correct.
Did we have to approve that? We have to approve the calendar.
Well,
do we have to move approve changes?
I don't think we actually have to approve testing dates.
Okay,
no.
That's fine. Mm-hmm. I just want to
unless someone that. Disagrees.
Which is Michelle.
The testing is the information.
Exactly. Right.
Okay. I just want to make sure. Okay.
Okay, that concludes my report.
Okay, as long as we're on the calendar, the next two meetings will occur in February, correct? Mm-hmm. Starting February, do you have the dates in front of you?
No, I left my calendar at home.
Thank you, Michelle.
10th.
10th, and therefore the 24th. In the interest of maximizing attendance, Cliff is going to be unavailable on the 10th, correct?
I'm going to be at a credit union conference.
Okay.
I will not be available on the 10th.
Is there, and there are some significant things that will be happening in February. I assume at some point you'll have a recommendation for us regarding 8th grade?
I will.
Okay. I know Dr. Sylvia would like to be present because that requires a school committee vote. At this point, do you think that that recommendation will be on the first meeting or the second meeting?
Dr. Sylvia, will you be here on the second meeting?
24th?
Yes.
Yes.
I will make the recommendation on the 24th.
Okay.
Is that your only concern then?
That's it.
Okay, great. Then I guess we don't need to change anything.
Okay.
All right. Let's see. I know you didn't have a quorum for the last policy review committee meeting.
Correct.
I'm sorry to hear that, and especially for you and others who were able to be there. So do you don't have anything to report, correct?
I can report we had no quorum.
Okay. I think the superintendent has already covered the her budget advisory meeting. We're moving well with the town, and we expect to come to a good resolution from the town and the school's perspective. Is there any other business that the committee would like to bring forth? None? Then I will take a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Roll call.
Yes.
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 We are adjourned. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hi, Judy.